700 megawatt Indian pressurized heavy water reactor, and this is third contribution from Mumbai chapter. Special welcome to Sri Balasubramaniam, Director Technical, NPCIL, Department of Atomic Energy, and welcome to all of you, our fellow members and outside of fellowship, whoever is listening to us. Mumbai chapter is having two co-conveners. One, Professor A.K. Suresh from IIT. Other one is Dr. Grover from Department of Atomic Energy. Our last two webinars were coordinated by Professor Suresh, and the present one was coordinated by Dr. Grover. Dr. Grover presently is of Department of Atomic Energy. He is member of Atomic Energy Commission and member of BRNS, which is a board for nuclear science researchers. Represents the department in various end science projects and projects. 2014. He is a Macaulay's engineering from Delhi College of Engineering, and did his PhD from ISC Bangalore. He is specialized in thermal hydraulics, reactor thermal hydraulics, including safety analysis. However, due to various requirements of the department, taking part in many other researches, like, as I say, that high value science projects like ITER and inside development. So with this small introduction, may I now request Dr. Grover to take over the session for further proceedings.
To welcome all the persons, all the participants, and I am happy to note we have a large participation today. Let me say that we have several webinars earlier, and this particular webinar is very important. Today's speaker is going to speak about pressurized heavy water reactors, which are the mainstay of nuclear power program in India. The program of setting up of PHWR started with plants of 220 megawatt rating. The first two were in Rawalpindi, next two in Kalpakkam, and then we moved to Narora, and setting up of the reactors at Narora, the design was standardized as well as indigenized. After setting up some more reactors of 220 megawatt size, the size was increased to 540 megawatt, and now NPCIL is moving to set up a series of 700 megawatt reactors. The first of the series has achieved first criticality, and we'll hear more about it from today's speaker, Sri Balasubramaniam. But before I hand over the mic to him, let me say a few words about the role of nuclear energy in India's electricity mix. Per capita electricity generation is very low in India, much lower than even the world average. If one plots Human Development Index, or HDI in short, versus per capita electricity consumption, one finds that HDI increases with increase in per capita electricity consumption, and then it slowly saturates. To have a high enough HDI, this particular plot tells us that one needs per capita consumption of about 5,000 units. Now, India's population is estimated to peak at 1.6 billion by the middle of this century. And if we consider transmission and distribution losses, 7%, which is the lowest technically feasible number, the total annual requirement in India will be 8,700 billion units per annum. How to generate this level of electricity? imperative of climate change requires that one deploys all low carbon technologies, and that would include hydro, nuclear, solar, and wind. One can see opinion in the literature that one should move to a frugal way of life and manage with only generation by renewables, but ground reality tells a different story. Per capita electricity consumption has been continuously rising for the last several years, with some flattening noticed in very recent times, particularly this year, and that is due to very abnormal situation created by pandemic. But one has to look at it from a different way. If we look at the increased, continuously increasing sales of air conditioners, various other electricity appliances, one can be sure of a continuous increase in the demand of electricity in the coming years. Demand for air conditioning is rising very fast, and India is the only country in the world where they have set up a separate action plan for cooling. It's not only air conditioning, demand for cold storages is rising, and cold storage capacity is increasing at the rate of 20% per annum. If you see other countries in very close proximity to India having similar climatic condition, let us say Malaysia, Thailand, they are already much above India in per capita consumption, Malaysia being almost at 4,000 and Thailand at 3,000. Hydro, solar and wind can at best provide about a quarter of the projected demand of 8,700 billion units, and the rest has to come from nuclear and coal. We have to ramp up nuclear installed capacity so that generation from coal can be reduced over the coming years. How long it will take for India to do so? That is something which NPCIL has to tell us. They are working to set up new power plants. Despite ongoing pandemic, NPCIL has managed to achieve first criticality in the 700 megawatt unit at Kakrapa, and many more similar units will come up in future. To tell us more about 700 megawatt units, we have with us today Shri A.K. Balasubramaniam. Many of you must have read his biodata in the flyer, and those who haven't, allow me to introduce him. It's on the screen. Mr. Balasubramaniam studied mechanical engineering at Regional Engineering College, Calicut, and then joined Bach Training School to study nuclear engineering. At present, he is working as Director, Technical NPCIL, and has the overall responsibility for design, engineering, procurement, safety analysis, technology development, health and environment safety functions pertaining to PSWRs. He has 35 years of experience, and besides looking at his assignment in NPCIL, he is a member of the board of Nuclear Fuel Complex Hyderabad. He is also on the board of Heavy Water Board. He is chairman of the joint venture of NPCIL IOL. And now I think I hand over to Balasubramaniam to go ahead with this talk. Mr. Balasubramaniam, please.
Good morning to all of you. And thank you very much, Dr. Grover, for the nice introduction. I am privileged to be able to make a presentation on the 700 megawatt pressurized heavy water reactor to this august and very learned audience. I place on record my sincere gratitude to the INAE management for inviting me, particularly to Dr. Grover and Dr. Mrs. S.B. Roy. Thank you very much. Now, let me start the presentation. Next slide, please. Okay. On 22nd of July this year, 2020, the first 700 megawatt unit, pressurized heavy water reactor unit, at Kakrapara Atomic Power Station became operational, having achieved the first controlled chain reaction, what we call as first approach to criticality. This is the 23rd nuclear power plant in the country and 19th in the series of pressurized heavy water reactors in the country. I must say that this is a major milestone in the saga of pressurized heavy water reactors in India. So while I will be talking specifics of this particular project, that is 700 megawatt PSWR, and the features and various other aspects, I feel it is pertinent and relevant to narrate the Indian nuclear power program, how and various initiatives were taken right in the beginning to ensure that India becomes self-reliant in this technology. That is the various initiatives for Atmanirbharta in this technology. So I'll spend some time on various aspects concerning this, and then followed by the 700 megawatt specifics. This is a very basic sketch showing what is different for a nuclear power plant compared to a conventional power plant. As you all know, we are talking about thermal reactors, wherein we use the fission of uranium-235 by thermalized neutrons, which provides large amount of energy and more number of neutrons to continue the fission chain reaction. So the nuclear reactor core is configured with uranium and a material for moderator, which is water or heavy water. So in this particular case of PSWR, it is heavy water. And of course, various control mechanisms. So this part of the power plant is different compared to the conventional power plant. The rest of the, once steam is generated, the rest of the power plant is similar to a conventional power plant. Now, if you look at the growth of Department of Atomic Energy, you can see that in the 40s, the basic research started in TIFR, followed by establishment of Atomic Energy Commission and DAE. Along with that, you will see that various institutions pertaining to power generation, that is various institutions, various organizations to support the nuclear power program, were simultaneously started by the then leaders. A separate division called Power Projects Engineering Division was created initially, which became Nuclear Power Board and the current Nuclear Power Corporation. In 1987, it became a corporation. So on the one hand, all the initiatives taken to ensure that the program is supported on all fronts, including the R&D by BARC. And on the other hand, simultaneously, the research reactors were also established to get hands-on experience on the reactor operation, so that in the next phase, the power reactors can be launched. So the Apsara reactor, which was at that time first in Asia outside USSR, was the first reactor in the country, followed by Cyrus, Zerlina, and Dhruva. So these provided rich experience in the operation. I must also add here that regulation is a very important aspect in the nuclear power industry, nuclear power stations. Therefore, the Atomic Energy Regulatory Board was also established in 1983, which evolved over a period of time to a complete maturity. Now, if you look at the nuclear power program in a capsule form, we are talking about the first stage of the three-stage program. We have three types of reactors, that is the initial BWRs at Tarapur 1-2 and the pressurized heavy water reactors which we are talking now. We have additionalities in terms of pressurized water reactors, that is VVR type, already working. So there are 22 reactors already in operation, giving us a total of 530 reactor years of safe operating experience. It's a huge experience that we have in the country. We have an ambitious program of expansion. Under construction, there are six. Of that, the Kakrapara 3 became critical, and it is in the process of raising the power very soon. The current status is, in spite of this COVID pandemic, after criticality, the other mandatory physics experiments have been completed in phase B, and it is poised for the phase C, which is a step increase of power in various steps. In addition to this, the Government of India has accorded sanction, including financial sanction, for 10 more of 700, which are to be implemented in fleet mode. So there are 16 units of 700 megawatt coming up. Let me very briefly introduce to you the concept of pressurized heavy water reactor. So we have already talked about the fission, and these reactors use small, about half a meter long, natural uranium fuel bundles. Next. So the making a power reactor with natural uranium and heavy water moderator and a channel type reactor. Next. So this requires continuous on power bidirectional fueling to ensure that sufficient reactivity is there in the core. So this is the basic concept of pressurized heavy water reactor. We will see more features as we go further. Next slide, please. Now, the first PHWR nuclear power station in India was built in RAPS 1 and 2. Looking at the history, in 1964, India-Canada joint venture was created for setting up these reactors. Majority of the work of design and supply was in the Canadian scope, and Indian scope was limited to construction, installation, and commissioning. This is our first step in building a power reactor. But unfortunately, Canada withdrew support after Pokhran tests in 1974. In 1973, the first unit became commercial, operational. And then after Canadians left, there was a gap of 8 years for the second unit to come up. Now, this is the point that I am trying to emphasize. This is where the initial infrastructure and various initiatives taken by the department started giving results, because for the second unit onwards, we were left on our own, and every aspect, starting from fuel, heavy water, various equipment, design, analysis, all these were carried out by the various units of DAE, including PPED at that time. So the remainder of the design, everything was done by India. And by 1981, we could successfully complete the second unit of the RAPS 1 and 2. Now, 1974, as I said, is the turning point, I must say, for the Indian nuclear power program, wherein we started completing the second unit of RAPS 2, as well as we initiated the construction of similar units at Kalpakkam, that is MAPS. These were constructed with indigenous efforts. In fact, you must notice that there are certain design changes were also done, like a dowsing tank replaced with vapor suppression pool. N-shield material particularly was changed from the original RAPS design to SS304L to take care of irradiation effect. So these units were completed in 84 and 86 respectively. Here you can see this is where another major milestone, you can say. This is the standardization of PHWRs. Here, major design and safety improvements were carried out, and it was a great learning experience as well, because we managed to, or we implemented a lot of safety systems. For example, two fast-acting independent and diverse shutdown systems came into existence from this reactor, replacing the earlier Canadian design altogether. Next click. So here you can see one is the gravity driven rods, the other one is a liquid poison based. So as a matter of fact, this liquid poison injection system was completely developed in India by our department. Then double containment concept was brought in. The Calandria and N-Shield became integral compared to discrete assemblies. Calandria vault filling with water, light water, and several features. High pressure emergency core cooling system. All these are very important for the design of a nuclear power plant. And all these were done, and these units went into operation in 93 and 95 respectively. So this is a great learning experience, and all these efforts are paying off for the later designs. Next. Once this standardization was done in Narora and Kakrapara, a series of reactors, that is 8 reactors, were built in Rajasthan 4 and Kaiga 4, retaining a majority of the design features of the earlier reactors. But one particular difference was the containment design, a dome-to-dome double containment, completely pre-stressed. Next. This construction is a forerunner to the subsequent reactors, wherein a feature for steam generator insertion or steam generator installation into the containment, and that allows us also to replace them when required. So this is a very significant change. In addition to that, the manual systems, which were power dependent for long-term shutdown, were replaced by what is known as a liquid poison injection system, which became standard in all these eight reactors. So this commercial operation of these units was between 2000 and 2011. That completed a series of 220 megawatt reactors. Next slide. Simultaneously, the NPB at that time was working on a higher sized reactor to get the benefit of economy of scale. In a pressurized heavy water reactor, when I say higher sized reactor, it entails certain additional new systems, such as the reactor control in 14 zones, introduction of in-core flux detectors, introduction of pressurizer, because you are handling larger volume, and things like that. So all these were worked out in-house. A lot of R&D went into the implementation of this. And these units were successfully completed in 2005 and 2006. I must say the construction and commissioning was completed within stipulated time, that is first pour to first criticality in 5 years was achieved for these new reactors at that time. Thanks to the entire infrastructure and capability that was built over the years, that is the Atmanirbharta of this technology. So in one slide, if you see, we started from RAPS 1-2 and up to TAPS 3-4, that is 540 megawatt. During this period, we have also generated a lot of experience and expertise in the country, leading to what is known as Atmanirbharta on this technology. Now, a couple of points here. One of the PHWR units, that is Kaiga 1, operated continuously for 962 days. That is a very important milestone in the history of PHWRs in India. Incidentally, I must also mention that the oldest reactor in the country, that is BWRs, TAPS 1 and 2, It has completed 50 years of operation. So these achievements, next slide, please, is the result of the expertise that is available in all fields for the entire lifetime of NPP in a single company. This is a very unique situation with our country. NPCIL, as a single organization, has got expertise in entire gamut of the activities pertaining to the nuclear power plants, particularly the PHWRs, starting from siting, design, the technology development, various analysis, construction, commissioning, operation, maintenance, refurbishment and modernization, plant life extension, etc. Now, I must mention here that as we saw earlier, the various organizations within the Department of Atomic Energy, namely UCIL, NFC, Heavy Water Board, ECIL, and the R&D Center, Bhabha Atomic Research Center, these are, apart from others, these are the main organizations which support the PHWR program to a great extent. So we must remember here our leaders, Dr. Homi Bhabha, Dr. Vikram Sarabhai during his time, this industrial organizations came into existence. Dr. Sethna, who introduced the fuel reprocessing and various other zirconium processing, etc. Simultaneously, the credit goes to the human resources development within the department. You're all familiar with the BARC training school. In addition to that, nuclear training centers were created at various NPCIL stations and the training centers at different DA units. In addition to that, entire lot of officers, engineers, they participate in international meetings and seminars to gain international experience as well. All these factors, plus the participation of Indian industries, has been extremely good. The industry has also developed the capability to manufacture major equipment of PHWRs, that is calendria, end shields, steam generators, C&A components, various pumps, etc. Today, most of the units are implemented through various packages. They could be construction packages or procurement and construction or engineering, a small engineering and procurement and construction. So these vendors for these type of packages have also got developed over the years. And one more information that I want to share with you is the large critical forgings required for steam generators, etc., are now indigenized. They are available within the country. So for the subsequent 700 megawatt units, we'll be depending on indigenous sources only. Now, this is the these are the various aspects pertaining to how the program developed, how the capability was created. Now, let me switch to the 700 megawatt PHWR specific. Now, after completing this 540 megawatt design, we started thinking about further enhancing the power from the same core, because we realized that the core is capable of giving at least 25% additional power. So the effort was how to extract this power, how to extract this thermal power from the fuel of the order of 25%. So the idea that was created is to allow partial boiling at the exit of various coolant channels. That is limited to 2 to 3%. So you can see the numbers here that culminated, that basic studies culminated in a reactor concept of 700 megawatt. So we thought that without changing the core design, that is keeping the fuel size, fuel bundles, number of channels, etc., same, we can create additional power to the extent of 540 to 700, that many megawatts. Now, if you look at the salient features of 700 megawatt, systems as required for larger reactors, which I explained in 540, they are retained in the 700. In addition, improvements in systems related to safety and various design aspects were also introduced because we took this opportunity to take all the feedback from the earlier reactors, including 540, and looked at the various requirements arising in the current time to meet all those requirements. Various features were introduced. In the process, we introduced many first-of-a-kind systems or features. Particularly, design extension conditions were addressed through design and accident management program. Now, today, what is in vogue is beyond design basis accidents. Usually, the nuclear power plants are assessed for what are known as design basis accidents. And it is demonstrated that even with the design basis accidents happening, there is no dose to the public at all. Now, as the things evolved, even before Fukushima, the 700 megawatt design started incorporating various features and systems to address the design extension conditions as well. Now, design extension conditions can be without core damage or with core damage. So both were addressed. Now, safety analysis has been done, which confirms that under all postulated conditions, these reactors meet the requirements. And multiple systems are provided to address all this. At this point, okay, there is a distortion in the picture. I'm sorry for that. But let me explain this. The PSWR has certain inherent advantages. For example, this is a pressure tube type reactor, not a pressure vessel type. So if there is a damage to a particular pressure tube, the consequences are limited to that pressure tube only, in general. Similarly, the pressure tubes are connected by various small diameter pipes carrying the coolant. So again, the discharge area is limited to that particular diameter only. This is one aspect. Second aspect is there is a large amount of water available for cooling the core in case of accident, and the progression of the accident can be retarded by using this water and augmenting this water. So certain studies have been done on this, and it has been proven that we can handle even such a very, very low probability event in PSWRs. This is a typical layout for 700 megawatt. The circuit shows the basic Calandria vessel, which is the core, the coolant circuit, that is the red lines coolant circuit. The coolant is taken to the steam generators. The heat is transferred to the secondary cycle and pumped back to the core. Such 392 coolant channels are there, which are arranged in a particular fashion. It has got a double containment, as was said earlier. And there are multiple systems to perform safety functions. Safety functions are basically reactor control, core cooling, and containment of radioactivity. Now, on various aspects, I'm going to briefly tell you the first-of-a-kind systems, design-related. So there is a limited boiling at channel outlet, and therefore there is a two-phase flow. This is addressed completely. We have introduced what is known as interleaving of feeders, the first two figures. Compared to 540, in 700, the looping is done in such a way that in case of a loss of coolant accident, postulated loss of coolant accident, the increase in reactivity, positive reactivity, can be limited. Similarly, the fuel transfer system, as I said earlier, the PSWRs require continuous refueling, that is using fueling machines. Now, the spent fuel has to be sent to what is known as a spent fuel storage bay. So compared to the earlier system, a lot of modifications and simplifications have been done by creating a design of mobile transfer machine, which carries the spent fuel and sends to the tray loading bay and then to the SFSB. So without going into much detail, What it gives us is less number of components, operational ease, and therefore less maintenance. In overall, it's operational ease and the man drum reduction. Similarly, we have various other design related first of a kind systems. Now we move on to power control. The power control, basically regulation is same using 14 zones by means of zone control system and control rods. The self-powered neutron detectors, which are distributed in the core for measuring flux. There has been some improvement in the construction of these SPNDs. There are two fast-acting shutdown systems as were there in 540. What is more important here is, since we have gone for higher power, that means we are extracting more power from the same bundle, additional monitoring and protection is required, what is known as regional overpower protection, compared to a core overpower protection, which was existing in 540, which is existing in 540. The reason being, a larger reactor, like pressurized heavy water reactor, it is prone to have some local flux peaking. If you don't monitor that, you will not come to know, and it can lead to some problem. So this monitoring and protection action based on that monitoring is created by means of this TRIP on regional overpower of the core. Similarly, the flux monitoring system, again using SPNDs, has been enhanced to give certain information which can be used to take care of the core control. On the right side is the actual top deck area where the reactivity devices terminate. This is the photo of Kakrabara 3. Now, with respect to core cooling, the normal force cooling is existing. Then we can introduce shutdown cooling at high temperature and high pressure. This is again a new thing. Thermosiphoning in case of force circulation. And two trains of emergency core cooling has been created to have further margin on the availability. Coming to containment of radioactivity, what is new here is the containment is a double containment, but the inner containment is lined with steel liners. This is again a first of a kind system, which has drastically reduced the leak rate from the containment and therefore contributing towards ALARA. Similarly, a containment spray system has been introduced to manage or take care of the pressure and radioactivity in case of a postulated LOCA. Further, the containment has several penetrations for cables. This has been improved by a special electrical penetration assemblies. So several such features have been added in 700 megawatt to take care of the safety issues. Now, some idea about management of design extension conditions. So for core cooling, a new system known as passive decay heat removal system, which enables continuous core cooling without operator intervention for at least 8 hours after a postulated design extension condition, namely station blackout. Further, this water inventory in the decay heat removal tank can be augmented so that we can continue core cooling by thermosiphoning for a very long time. So this is a very good system taking care of design extension conditions. There are many, hookup points are added. That is, today, what we thought is, in addition to the existing water resource within the plant, additional water can be brought either through tankers or through hoses from nearby large storage of water and put into various relevant systems to continue the core cooling for a longer time. There are many others, I'm not going into the details, except, the one important aspect is, in case of a design extension condition, which in which results in a situation where the main control room cannot be occupied, and the site has to continue further measures to mitigate. A on-site emergency support center is getting created actually, where all facilities for monitoring the status of the reactor, severe accident parameters monitoring system is provided, and all the means for taking various actions is provided in this particular building, which is seismically qualified, radiation, lot of shielding is provided, etc. Other features in terms of deck management include passive catalytic recombiner devices for recombining hydrogen, which may get generated during a design extension condition. Hydrogen, as you all know, is getting generated because of the zirconium metal and water reaction at high temperature. So this comes out of the core and then pressurizes the containment. So it is necessary that the hydrogen concentration is reduced, and the limit is below the deflagration level of hydrogen within the containment. As a further defense, in case the containment pressure increases beyond the design pressure, we have a system created, what is known as containment filtered venting system, which can be opened, which can be used to depressurize the containment, as well as scrub down the various fission products in a tank, and then the release can be done. So this ensures that the containment integrity will be intact. Now, measures to address design extensions were actually a part of original design. For the earlier reactors, they are getting retrofitted subsequent to the Fukushima accident. With containment intact, even for the worst postulated accident that is leading to a design extension condition, there is no requirement of evacuating and relocating public from the exclusion zone, beyond the exclusion zone. So this is a very important feature which is built into the design to address the necessity of building more and more reactors in our country, which is thickly populated. So we have already gone one step beyond the current requirements, and to ensure that the safety is fully addressed. Now, all this first-of-a-kind system qualification has been done. This was a huge process. Nevertheless, everything was done either in in-house facilities like hydrogen recombiner test facility at R&D Center Tarapur, NPCL R&D Center at Tarapur, or the containment spray system testing done at Kakrapara site, or the PDHRS test. PDHRS is passive decay heat removal system test done at a NPCL thermohydraulic test facility at R&D Center Tarapur. Next. Now, a few moments on T&I design. We are following hardware design for safety systems and computer-based systems for what are known as next level of safety, that is IB and lower safety classes, and independent verification and validation of all computer-based systems is done. The architecture is a mix of cluster-based distributed systems and standalone systems. The control room, main control room, is state-of-the-art with soft controls, which reduces the burden on the operator compared to the earlier design. Operator workstation and soft controls. There is a supplementary control room for achieving basic safety functions. Now, all this hardware and software are developed, designed, and tested in-house. That means complete capability exists, and the entire IPR is with NPCIL. For this purpose, there is a dedicated prototype system laboratory is available in Mumbai, where a group of engineers continue to work on development and testing. Now, for nuclear power plants, it is necessary to have a training simulator, which is a full scope replica of the plant. This is also developed in house, and for Kakrabara 3, I am happy to say that this was commissioned prior to criticality, which is the mandatory requirement nowadays, and the operators are already trained in this simulator. Next slide, please. Now, I am moving on to the implementation part. All designs and analysis and testing having done, when it comes to the implementation aspect, there are a couple of very important points. Keep on clicking. So here in this animation, please click continue. What I'm trying to show is how the construction progresses at site of a particular building. I've taken reactor building. So from the first pour of concrete as zero, in 42 months, this entire building comes up along with installation of equipment, various equipment. So for which there are certain timelines. Now, if you take the project schedule, overall project schedule, there is one part known as pre-project and the other one is actual execution. And many a times the engineering is to some extent concurrent, particularly because the engineering needs to take care of the site-specific inputs. Now, from engineering, all the specifications and drawings for equipment supply is created, as well as the design deliverables in terms of drawings and specification for actual construction work. They are also generated. So we have coined the name planned engineering, which is an integration of all these activities to dovetail with the project implementation schedule. This is from Kakrabara onwards. We are doing it in a 3D environment, which captures all the details so that when the drawings are extracted from this 3D, they are ready for construction. And all the bill of materials, all the quantities, specifications, can also be built in the 3D model. So this enables an integrated approach for the project implementation with a great focus on time and quality. Now, have a word about fleet mode. As I said, 6 units are under construction or commissioning. 10 units are to be implemented in fleet mode. When I say this fleet mode, the connotation is one after the other, the implementation should go on. This requires bulk procurement, standardization of design, about which I'm going to talk in the next slide. The sites are in Gorakhpur, Haryana. Already there are 2 units coming up. Beyond that, 2 more units. In Kaiga, where there are 4 units already, 2 more units of 700. Chutka in Madhya Pradesh, 2 units. And another site in Rajasthan, apart from the current Rawatbata, this site is known as Mahi Baswada. There are 4 units coming up. So 10 units coming up for which financial sanction exists. So there is a very ambitious expansion program to be implemented in the next nearly 12 years. Yeah. Now, therefore, there is a need to standardize the future units. That means the fleet mode will be a standard. So GHVP 1 and 2, which is the current projects about to start construction, it is in a loose soil site. So GHVP 1 and 2 and 3, 4, they will be same design. When we go to the other design, it is all a rock foundation. So we'll have one design for all those 6, about 8 reactors. Yeah, 8 reactors are rock foundation. So we'll go for one design of that. And for the loose soil, one design. That is the standard design we are talking. And therefore, this GHVP 1 and 2, the basic design, layout and systems and structures, they will be standard because they are capturing the feedback that is coming from the current projects at Kakrabara and Rajasthan. So analysis and qualification of SSCs on account of site-specific, particularly the seismic, they will be done to ensure that the layout, etc., is meeting the requirements there. And re-engineering will be limited to only site-specific, for example, water systems, power evacuation, etc. And we go for a standardized procurement specification. Already procurement specifications are all standardized. Bulk procurement for multiple units. So this also has been initiated. For example, the raw materials, namely forgings and plates required for multiple units are already under under manufacturing. Then major equipment such as calandria and shield steam generator, they are for multiple units are under ordering. So this will help us in saving time and also cost reduction. Safety analysis also has been standardized. We don't repeat every time. An enveloping type of analysis is provided. Technical specification for operation is also getting standardized so that all 700 megawatts will have a common tech spec. In order to improve efficiency in the procurement, the QAP, quality assurance plan, is made part of the specification with already approved QAP. Next, please. Now, during this implementation of Kakrapara 3 and of course the subsequent units, we have faced some challenges. I will try to narrate this. The most important aspect is the financial status of various contractors. After taking the contracts over the period, the contractors were not able to mobilize resources and complete the project on time for, among other reasons, one is the financial problems. So this is an issue. But then today, for the future, what we are doing is the contracts are formulated in such a way that financially weak vendors are not qualified. Then, since it is a fleet mode, that means 10 units in a very short time, we need to have more industries and more vendors to be brought in. We have already tried to do this in the current projects, and that will pay, that will yield results for the fleet mode as well. Various package vendors, when they supply equipment or components, they also have to qualify them for example, seismic or radiation, etc. So a lot of analysis work is involved where they employ engineering consultants. So there is they look for qualified engineering consultants who are already doing the job. So if you look at the Kakrapara 3 various jobs, this has been addressed, and we need to enhance the availability of such engineering consultants. You are all familiar with CLND clause, that is nuclear damage liability. So there was some issue in the initial part of implementation of GHAP 1 and 2, where because of various doubts, vendors were somewhat apprehensive about quoting. Now, I must say that for pressurized heavy water reactors, all these issues have been settled, and the responsibility is with NPCIL, because NPCIL is the prime designer for this. So these issues are more or less, I must say, closed for the future PHWRs. Then this COVID-19 pandemic really affected the progress of the projects. In fact, Kakrapara 3 criticality was achieved in spite of these limitations. I must say that in the commissioning and towards criticality, a lot of involvement of various agencies like designers, developers, they're all required to ensure that the commissioning is done as per design intent. Similarly, the regulatory review process is also quite elaborate. And all this normally requires a lot of interaction. So during this pandemic period, we had to use virtual methods, virtual resources to carry out these discussions. And site, many of the designers, actually nobody from design office could go to site. The site managed everything with good interaction with designers and regulators during this period. and made it happen. That is the criticality to happen. And subsequent to that also, the progress is not sufficient because of the pandemic-related issues. But the entire organization is gearing up and trying to overcome this. So these are some of the challenges faced and some of the challenges we may face and how to tackle them. There are a good amount of thought on this front. So to sum up, the pressurized heavy water technology, there is comprehensive expertise and experience existing within NPCIL, DA units, and the Indian industries. So this is a case of Atmanirbharata in the PHWR technology. The 700 megawatt PHWR, as I explained, is a state-of-the-art design meeting latest regulatory requirements, and I must say one step ahead. We are looking at design standardization so that we can implement the fleet mode quite efficiently, as efficiently as possible, in order to cut down any delays. All these efforts are on, and the organization is poised for rapid capacity addition in fleet mode. And thank you very much for your kind attention. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Balasubramaniam, for an excellent exposure to 700 megawatt reactors in a very short period. We started late, but you have stuck to your timings. You have completed. And I must say that having brought the reactor to first criticality in this pandemic situation is definitely an achievement, and NPCIL team needs to be complimented for this achievement. To participants, please post your questions in the Q&A box so that we can, Mr. Balasubramaniam will be happy to respond to various questions. So let me see. Yes, so far there is no question. Let me start with a question myself. Balasubramaniam, how many more, you must have a timetable now going forward in spite of pandemic situation to move to commercial operation in a graduated manner. Can you throw some light on the manner in which you are planning to proceed towards commercial operation? How many weeks more or how many months it will take to reach that stage?
Yeah. As you know, the from criticality to full power operation, we go through initially certain number of experiments, and the power is raised in steps. And at various power levels, there are some mandatory tests to be done. And we have to ensure that it meets the design and regulatory requirements. So originally, the planning was July 22nd criticality, and we thought in 5 months, 6 months, we should be able to reach 100% full power. So now we have lost some time. So we are trying to pick up that. Today, the status is the station is poised for power rate. So at least 5 months, at least 4 months from now, at least 4 months.
4 months. Okay, thank you. And now I have, I think, a couple of questions. One is from Mr. Gantayat, as to fleet mode execution requires higher investment on the part of vendors. Is there a plan to utilize the same infrastructure beyond 12 years? So beyond this fleet mode, what are the further plans of NPCIL?
Yes, we have plans for further addition of megawatt units, which some sites are identified. But to definitely say, we need to have sanctions, the financial sanctions from government of India. With respect to financial sanctions, we don't have. But at the same time, we have the LWR projects coming up, namely the Kudankulam 3, 4, and 5, 6, and the likely projects from the American side and French side. So put together, we can say that the vendors or the manufacturers may not have to keep their manufacturing units idle, even beyond this fleet mode.
There's a question from Prabhat Munshi. I have a, he writes that he has a question on 700 megawatt analysis, safety analysis. Prabhat, can you, exact question, can you write down so that Mr. Balasubramanian will answer that? In the meanwhile, I'll take up the question from Mr. Sanat Kumar. He is saying that is a plan to use fuel other than natural uranium in 700 megawatt PSWR?
I must say, sir, there is thought of using slightly enriched uranium. Preliminary work is going on now, so we will see as we proceed, because right now our focus is to implement the 700 as a replica of the current project, current design. Nevertheless, some initiative is there from NPCIL and DAE to look at possibility of using slightly enriched uranium. Work is has just begun, sir.
Now, Professor Prabhat Munshi has written on the question. He writes that boiling results in 3% quality at the outlet, and this may introduce some instability, like it can happen in a BWR. What kind of safety analysis has been done for this purpose?
There is 2 to 3% boiling at the end of the channels. Because of the compressibility effect, there can be a instability in case of a transient. Now, there are methods for addressing this. For example, if you think this as a circular pipe, we can have a diameter like a diagonal like a pipe attached to equalize. So one option is pressure equalization lines, which we have already provided. Second one is inherently this design has got what is known as a pressurizer. Pressurizer is a tank, a surge tank, which quenches various pressure oscillations in the system. This has been introduced, and we know the experience from 540 megawatt onwards. Now, we have done analysis for this instability, considering only pressurizer on the one hand and considering only the equalization lines on the other hand. Any one is adequate. So today our understanding is with pressurizer available, all these instability issues can be addressed. Analysis has demonstrated that. But in the current design, we have also put the equalization line. So we will take a call to remove it later if required. So it's very, very well addressed and debated.
Fleet mode has been introduced. There is no evident effort to remove the misconceptions in the public about radiation, etc. Is there an intensive effort planned?
Okay. I'm not sure whether I understood the question. Is there an intensive plan for public awareness?
Yeah,
definitely. So NPCIL has a dedicated public awareness program which includes lectures and demonstrations to various college students and schools and public at large. In addition, the people are invited, students are invited to the stations to show them physically what we claim as a safe power plant. So there is a dedicated effort at NPCIL as well as in DAE for public awareness on the radiation or what we say as nuclear power plants do not add additional radiation dose to the environment.
Okay, now I'm able to manage to read the question in Q&A box. There's a question from Dr. Ganguly. Can the PSWR 540 units at TAPS be upgraded to PSWR 700 to compensate? Can we upgrade the unit at TAPS units also to higher value?
Considering that, change that we have implemented in 700 is respect to the heat extraction system. The steam generators are sized to that kind of additional thermal value. And similarly, the heat exchangers, other heat exchangers in the cooling stream, they are all sized for higher heat, including moderator system. So changing the steam generators, although theoretically possible, it will entail huge investment and huge time. So perhaps at this moment, I feel that the existing 540, although the core is capable of giving commensurate power, extraction is not possible.
Okay, there's another question from Dr. Ganguly. It's about accident tolerant fuels. He is asking, is there a need to develop accident tolerant PSWR fuels?
The accident tolerant fuel requirement is more pertinent to PWRs, pressurized water reactors.
Yes, yes.
Understanding for pressurized heavy water reactors, this is not that relevant.
Next question is on cyber security from Mr. Dr. R.K. Singh. What steps have been taken in that area?
Okay, sir. On cyber security, first let me make a statement. The control systems, the systems which are required for the plant, they are first, they are developed in-house, they are tested, they are subjected to various reviews, and they are independent of the network, that is local area network, which is used for administrative or other regular aspects. So for the controls, for the computers which are dedicated to planned control and various functions, they have no link to the external network at all. So that is a basic thing that we need to understand here. Plus, when we develop these systems, these hardware or software, there is a very well laid down procedure to ensure cybersecurity within that itself. Now, okay, so what we have done is we have reviewed this in great detail. There was a discussion with the regulators as well, and all the compliances are being shown to them to demonstrate that our plants are safe from cybersecurity threats.
There's a question from Mr. Kotwal. One of the aims of the fleet mode was to identify companies for batch ordering of major components. To what extent has this been actually achieved for major reactor components? Have long-term partners been identified in this regard?
Very relevant. See, as a corporation, nuclear power corporation, as a corporation, we are mandated to go for bulk procurement. At the same time, the framework or the boundaries are also drawn so that we are forced to go for public tendering for various equipment. What Mr. Kotwal is indicating is identifying and giving the order to a particular company for certain component for the entire bulk procurement. That has not materialized in spite of some initial discussion. So today the situation is we are going for public tendering, and based on that, we are awarding the contract for equipment for multiple units as per the contract tender conditions. These orders are just happening.
Okay. There is one more question from Mr. Kotwal. CLND issues, to what extent they have increased the cost of the plants?
Okay. As I said, initially, yes, this apprehension was there because the vendors also will have to add that buffer into the subsequent obligations if called for. But for pressurized heavy water reactors, now we have very clearly brought out that the designer is NPCIL. So the vendors do not have obligation for liability. So at least with that understanding, it should not affect the various costs quoted by vendors.
In short, there is no increase in cost for vendors. And he's again asking about any progress with regard to export of PSWRs.
It's actually, as the 2 megawatt as a standard product was envisaged that we can sell it to the third world countries. A lot of efforts were made to produce a package, complete package of design deliverables. From that, subsequently, for reasons I do not know at this moment, that did not take off. So now, maybe once 700 becomes standardized, there is still an opportunity because 700 is an attractive size for various countries.
Another question is regarding cost per megawatt and how it compares with the cost of thermal plants.
What we must look at is the tariff, the electricity tariff that we are selling at. You'll be surprised to know that the tariff of Tarapur 1-2, electricity from TAPS 1 and 2, the earlier BWRs, is so low. It is only 1 rupee plus we are selling at a rate. And our average tariff today is somewhere around 3.5 rupees, which is comparable to the tariff from thermal plants. So nuclear power plants have this inherent advantage of less operating cost. And over the period, the tariff becomes very competitive.
Now, there's a question from Mr. Ravinder Kale as to, you said that 10 units will be built in 12 years. So what kind of planning has been done to ensure that NPCIL is able to build the units in 12 years?
Yes, sir. There are 2-3 initiatives. One is the pre-project activities at these sites are to be completed expeditiously, because that makes a lot of difference to start the project. To reach the stage of first pour of concrete, there is a good amount of work to be done. So there is a good amount of focus on this aspect. Second is, as I described in my presentation, standardization of the design so that the design deliverables and the data required for equipment procurement is available on time. Third thing is the advanced procurement of equipment and raw material. This is with a view that we should be able to implement in time. Now, I must say, with a lot of credit to the Indian industry, the current manufacturing for GHAP 1 and 2, the major equipment, they are progressing exceedingly well. That is, we don't envisage the kind of delay that we faced in the earlier projects for the new projects. So a lot of attention is there, so that we are able to utilize this opportunity of, the sanction, the financial sanction that has been given by the government of India, and we want to rise up to the expectations.
Yeah, another question, I think same question from Professor Muralidhar and Professor Suresh regarding the use of supercritical carbon dioxide and Brayton cycle in place of steam. Is there any thinking in this regard? I think, to my knowledge, this is not being looked at for PSWR. Yes, we are looking at Brayton cycle, etc. for compact high temperature reactor at conceptual stage. Some work is being done in PARC in this area. Now, this is question from Praveen Kumar. Does cost of production of electricity is taken from cradle to grave, that is from raw material to production? How with respect to thermal power generation, which is more cheaper? I think consumption is presumptive. He is already assuming thermal power is cheaper. His question is, cost of production of electricity, does it take care of all costs from cradle to grave? Then the question is that about the tube sheet material. It is from Mr. Bhanushankar, Dr. Bhanushankar Rao. It has vanished. Let me locate it again. That there has been some problem with this tube sheet material in the past. Think, let me get the question again. It was there. Can you comment on pressure tube ZERC 2.5 niobium, which had problems in the earlier reactor? Are we considering pressure tube replacement if required? Yes, replacement is always built in the design, right?
Pressure tube material over the years got developed and the manufacturing process was fine-tuned. The last version, or the latest version, is from forged route, and we expect at least anywhere between 20-25 years of life for the pressure tubes. Today, what we are getting is somewhere between 15 to 20 years. So we are from this current 700, we are trying to enhance the life to 20 to 25 years. Yes, pressure tube replacement at least once will be required in the reactor life of 40 years.
There's a question from Dheeraj Patil. Sir, do you use metal 3D printer for critical parts for better supply and design efficiency?
Yes, of late, yes, our manufacturers have started using 3D printing. But it is not in very advanced stage for deployment in our industry.
There was a question I read some time back, but now I don't see on the screen. It's regard to all the vendors are from India or from outside?
Yeah, all the vendors are from India, majority. There are today, the situation is the import is limited, very much limited to a few components like transmitters, or some radiation resistant cameras and some C&I components. As I said in my presentation, the critical forgings which were earlier being imported are now available in the country, and we insist on getting from them. Similarly, the circular tube NFC is making. So we have a good amount of import substitution now, and practically the entire thing is supplied from India. Being supplied from India for the current projects.
In percentage term, can you quantify it? It's 98% Indian, 97% Indian.
Maybe we can say if you take the turbine rotor, that is one item which is still not manufactured. So maybe 90 to 95% is Indian.
98%. Okay.
90 to 95. Between 90 and 95.
Between 90 and 95. There's a question from Mr. R.B. Verma. With our decision to standardize 700 megawatt reactors, what will be the future of fast breeder reactors? I think these two are independent stream.
Yeah.
Fast breeder reactors will follow PSWRs, and we'll continue to work on fast breeder reactors. And then a question from Mr. Praveen Kumar, which I spoke earlier, cradle to grave, whether that we are trying to answer when the connection went off. Cost of production of electricity, does it include all costs from cradle to grave?
Yeah, that question is relevant because fuel, actually spent fuel is not a waste, it's a resource. So the plutonium that is extracted from the spent fuel is not accounted. Similarly, various reprocessing activities are not accounted. So in short, the entire activities from cradle to grave are not accounted in the cost of the current costing methodology for future wars.
The cost of nuclear power we always take from cradle to grave, right from mining of uranium to waste management, even the cost of decommissioning is also included in the tariff which is charged to the customers. So that this way, right from cradle to grave, all cost is included. And I think I'll just take now one or two more questions because we are going late. I think Mr. Sunil Sherlekar, I noticed that end-to-end energy efficiency about 30%. Please explain what are the challenges to increase this, well, Carnot cycle. The temperatures in PSWs are not very high, so efficiency is about 29%, 30%. Then Mr. Narayana, J.R. Narayana, so far we are knowing that achieving 700 megawatt is by allowing partial boiling, but one of your slides shows that even the fission power is increased from 1830 megawatt to 2290 megawatt. Do you anticipate additional functional burden on fuel bundles?
So what we are doing in existing fuel bundles, that is 7-element fuel bundles, they are the same bundles are used, but we are extracting little higher power from the bundle. That means the bundle limit is slightly increased with the sufficient safety margin in 700 vis-a-vis 540, and we increase the flux so that the bundle generates that amount of fission power. Then our job is to extract that, for which we have made the modifications in the process system.
Does it impose any additional manufacturing improvements were necessary for this purpose?
No. It is originally the rating of 3711 bundle is, let us say, some value. In 540, we were using a lower fraction of the total rated power. In 700, we have raised this value, still meeting all the safety criteria. So there is no additional design effort required.
Okay, now I think I'll take the last question. What will be the amount of uranium required for 540 megawatt reactors and 740 megawatt reactors? So per reactor, you can give
so,
some.
Yeah. So it is the something like 100 tons to 125 tons difference, roughly.
Okay. So, Mr. Balasubramanian, there are many people have written compliments to you for your excellent presentation. I also joined them that yes, it was an excellent presentation, informative presentation. So, thank you very much. I hope there may be some questions which people will have it. I have tried to look at all the questions and raise them, but in case I have missed any, I'm so excuse me for that, because we are already at now 12:53, and I request Dr. Saraswati Roy to propose a vote of thanks.
Sir, thank you very much, sir, for giving me this opportunity. I have tried my level best to make the presentation and answer the questions. Thank you very much to all of you.
I think today we must compliment and give the thanks to our Professor Basu Rao, who so quickly taken over from that problem, and because of him we could distribute continue this lecture, and it's such an excellent lecture. Thanks again to Balasubramanian, especially his special effort to handle this with so much respect and care. I sincerely thank him. I thank INA head office to maintain all connectivities and giving all the informations and time to fellowship. It was an excellent support for us. At the same time, I must remember the help the supports provided by our colleagues from DAE presently and those who were there earlier, who made this path of Atmanirbharata from the very beginning and made such an excellent job to be possible. I was listening to Professor Murthy's talk, where he was putting it in such a way that many a times denials have made us move strong on this Atmanirbharata. But I must inform you all, in case of atomic energy, it is much before that denial, from the very beginning, in the year of 1936 or so, that time itself, they had a thought that most of the things we wanted to make on our own, when all the hills are available. Just for information, premium fuel, though it was available from Canada, but the then political conditions and our bosses or the superiors, they decided to have the plant at the beginning so that we can make the half charge when full charge was available from outside. So this is the way we have progressed. So we must thank to all our seniors for making this way, it is making this all these things possible. So thank you everybody, and I must thank to our audience who patiently waited to listen this nice lecture and actively participated in question answer session. Thank you again. Thanks to INEA, thanks to Vasudev Rao, and lastly, thanks to Grover for taking all the pain and conducting this session. Thanks a lot.